Well, I have a wonderful electronic invention I want you to see. See?
It looks something like you.
Welcome back to Chapter 4. In this second clip, we are going to continue setting up the main logic system.
Last time, we made a couple of tests to find out which points can place objects with specific requirements. I'm going to separate the rail into segments. That allows me to ignore certain segments like a tunnel, and I can apply some rules. In my case, I want to suggest that the tunnel is already providing some support, which means you will have no objects placed in front of the tunnel. Let me explain how I intended the whole support system to work. It should be complex enough to reflect the terrain and how towers, tunnels, and bridges are providing support to the rail. But it should be simple enough to allow easy debugging and later changes. You could bring in complex formula to calculate stability of a structure, but that wouldn't be practical at all. It needs to be a lot more simple than that. It should be something that you can easily explain to others and allow quick adjustments. So my strategy is that specific points will hold a certain support value, not even a float, but just a simple integer. Let's say a point has a support of 5. That support is then distributed to the neighbors, 4, 3, 2, and 1. Then the system will notice that the point after that has 0 support. That means it needs to place something there, a tower maybe, that will provide its own support. The challenge will be not to just place it right there, where there is already no support. If the tower provides again 5 support, it should be placed further ahead. And when its support is distributed, all points should have at least 1 support. When we continue that process, we end up with a rail covered with support. But first, we need to notice a switch in the segment. It could be done in easier ways, since I only have tunnels and not tunnels, but I wanted to have a system that could be extended to multiple possible options. And this is how I did that. The wrangle will be on detail. The first task is to give each point a specific segment ID that shows where it belongs. So I create that ID and directly apply it with 0 at the first point. I'm going to need 2 variables to signal a change in the groups. That's when we will know there's a different segment. First, I'm initializing the variable inTunnel with what point 0 is in. You can use the function inPointGroup for that. If the point is in it, it returns 1. If it's not, it returns 0. That can also be used as a condition in an if statement. Now I want to go over all of my points with a for loop. I already covered point 0, so I begin with 1. At the start, I set the mismatch to 0. That way, each iteration starts with a clean slate. Now I check if the value in the variable inTunnel is not equals the result of the inPoint group using I as point number to get the current iteration. If it is not equal, we have a mismatch. You would do that for each of your possible groups. After that, you look at the mismatch, and if it is set, we put the new value into the inTunnel variable. So either 1 or 0. If I reach this point, I have either reached a tunnel or just left a tunnel. That means we can now increase the segment ID. In any case, the current point gets its own segment ID, which either stayed the same or was increased. Looking at the spreadsheet, we can see that we ended up with 5 segments, going from 0 to 4. Looking at our terrain, that seems to be right. We have 2 areas where the tunnels are created, 1 segment at both the beginning and the end, and 1 short segment connecting the tunnels. Later we will need to know how many points each segment has. That is fairly easy to get with 1 line of VEX. We want a new attribute called segment length, and we fill it with the function findAttribValCount. This will look at the point attribute segment ID and count how many have the same value as the current point. Now each point knows in what segment he belongs and how many points are in the segment. Next, we need an overall info about the amount of segments. We can see there are 5. But how to tell that to a loop? Another way to grab information like this is using the attribute promote node. We can look at the segment ID and turn it into a new detail attribute using the maximum method. That way we get the max segments attribute. With that available, we can do a for loop using the number preset. It will do a fixed number of iterations. We just need to tell it to use that attribute. To make it easier to read, let's rename this node find max segments. When we go down to the end node, we can now enter an expression into the iteration parameter. That expression grabs the detail attribute of that node with the name we choose, and we need to add 1 to that. The amount of loop iterations start to count with 1, while our first segment and the iteration counter of the loop starts at 0. So what to do once we are in the loop? I do a turn for each segment, so I only want to look at each segment on its own. The curve is still connected, so the easiest way to get one segment at a time is to get rid of what is not part of one segment that is active for one iteration. Another wrangle that I call current segment is going to do that. Connect the meta node into the second input for easy access of its attributes. Because when you look at this node, you can see that it holds some detailed attributes, like on what iteration are we on and how many iterations are there in total. Very handy. Let's write this in a readable way. First, I get the value behind the iteration attribute. That starts with 0 and goes up to 4. That means we can remove all points that have a segment ID unlike the current iteration. That means we now have direct access to each segment by itself. That does also mean that point number 0 and the last point is no longer start and end of the whole curve, but from just this segment. We can use that like so. If we are on point 0, this is the start of a segment. And then just if this is the start of a tunnel, we apply a certain amount of support to this point. The tunnel begins, so it doesn't need external support structures like towers. I will also apply a trigger attribute on this point. It signals that it has support to be distributed to the neighbors. More on that soon. I do the same with the last point, which marks the exit point of the tunnel. Here we apply the same, a certain amount of support, and then a trigger attribute. Let's switch the visualizers to show support and the distribute trigger. If we now take a look at the spreadsheet, we see that we see nothing. There is no support nor a trigger attribute. We also don't see any visuals in the viewport. But that is actually correct. We are looking at a segment that is not a tunnel. Also, we have not yet set the value for the tunnel strength channel. So let's switch to the second segment, and this one is a tunnel, and you can see the yellow one at each end of it. This seemed to work for all segments as it should. Let's take a closer look at the spreadsheet, just to be sure we did everything correctly. We have one start and one endpoint according to the available segments, so we did everything correctly. Before we go further, copy the code of this wrangle. I want to apply another rule, and that is that the global start and end should also have an initial support. It doesn't make sense to create objects right at the corner of the scene. At the very least, you should be able to apply something there to control it. Create a new wrangle, and this is start and end global. Paste in the snippet we created before, and now we just have to get rid of everything we don't need. We don't need to set an attribute or the segment test anymore, so we'll throw that away. Instead of tunnel strength, we get this value from a new channel, and I call that border strength. Remember that all of these attributes go to the control node at the end of this chapter. That leaves us with one final task, and that is to do the actual support distribution. This will be a piece of coding that we can reuse in the main algorithm. But before the main logic can figure out where to place objects, the initial support needs to be set. In this wrangle, we are going to deal with the local and offset support, and we want to loop over specific points this time. All the points that have support to distribute. There's a special form of a for loop that allows us to do that. As usual, we start with 4 and then call the counter pt. This time it gets filled by a colon followed by the function findAttribVal. We provide the point attribute to distribute with a value of 1. And now we loop just over those few points that have the trigger attribute. All the start and end points of the tunnels and the two global border points. First, we need to find out what this point's support is. That is the local support. Then we create a nested loop starting from that point with the trigger plus 1. So it's direct neighbor. And the loop continues until we reach the point number plus that local support. Now we want to get the support that should be added to that neighbor. That difference is the initial local support minus the counter variable minus pt. That means if that local support is, let's say, 5, and we are currently looking at point 10, that is distributing its support, I would be the point 11. So 11 minus 10, that's 1. Local support minus 1 is what should be added to point 11. So for point 12, that would be 5 minus 12 minus 10, which results in 3 additional support for point 12. I want to make sure that I add that support on any existing support. So I grab the support of that offset point and then I can add the difference to it. After that, I set the value as a new support attribute. That covers the distribution to the next points, but we also need to apply that to the points behind us. So copy and paste this whole block. And while this was the forward distribution, this is now the backward distribution. This is another good opportunity to talk about scope of variables. That is the right term for what I explained earlier about variables that are created inside these blocks. I have a second identical if block that uses the same variables, like the int counter called I and the difference variable I also created inside the block. All I have to do is change the leading sign of these operations. Now I is pt minus 1, and I continue until I is bigger than pt minus local support. And this loop is decrementing the variable. Also, the difference is calculated slightly different by turning pt and I around. But I can absolutely use the variable I and difference, even though I used them in the block before. The backwards block doesn't know the variable difference, since it is only in the scope of the forward block. So here's a challenge for you. When do we have to declare a variable like difference at the top of our coding? And when can we do that inside of a block? And even declare it another time in another block, like I just did? Feel free to pause the video and give it a thought. And continue once you have an answer.
Just to be clear, if you have no idea, you can now continue to watch the video. He will explain it now. That was an educational tool. Because he is fancy or lame. You decide.
The answer to that is, you only need to declare the variable outside of the block if you not only need it again, but you also need to know with what value this variable comes out of the last block. So in my case, since I don't care about what difference values it had during its last iteration, I can declare it once again, without getting any syntax errors. The same goes for the counter variable I. And finally, something very Houdini specific. Again, something about scope, but this time about attributes. As I explained, I read the support of the offset point, so that I can add the new support on top of that. So if it already has any support value on it, from a tunnel maybe, I don't want to override that. This is how I will do it later in the main process, where I go through each point by itself. But right now, I go over all the points with one single wrangle. This is something totally different and absolutely confused me when I started learning Houdini and VEX. While I can write whatever I want into variables, the final values of attributes are only applied after the wrangle is finished processing. So even if I write a new support value, like you see here in line 15, if I later read the attribute again, it will be whatever the wrangle started with. So for this wrangle, every time I read the point attribute support from an offset point, that will be always zero at this stage. Also important to mention, this doesn't count if you're on a point wrangle and change the global attributes like at P. You're directly manipulating the attribute on that specific point. Here, in my case, I am on a detail wrangle and create my own loop over all points. That's what makes the difference. For some, that might sound obvious, but if you're not aware of that, it's one nasty pitfall. Since we don't need to look at the offset support at all, there's no reason to make that step so obvious with these lines. There's another way how we could write that part. You provide the difference to the setPointAttrib function, but change the mode from set to add. Now the difference is also added to the existing values. And finally, at the very end of the loop that went through all the points with something to distribute, we want to toggle these points off. Here we once again use the mode toggle in the setAttrib function. And there you have it. We no longer have points to distribute because all of them already did so. The support is provided to the neighbors by steps of one. This will allow us quite some control where to place objects and how far they can spread support while still being fairly simple to debug and customize.
With that, we prepared the logic system to go into its main calculation, where towers and bridges should be placed. So if you want to know how to create that system, come back next time, or don't, and never discover the secret knowledge of procedural sci-fi construction planning, a very important skill to have. Maybe. Someday. Whatever. Come back to the next video, subscribe, hit the bell icon, pet a dog, wear a mask, any other stuff you have to do, but mainly, subscribe to the channel